Hi everyone, and welcome back to my profile here. I'm Sandy Adams. I am a social media brand strategist and a photographer, and I'm located in Memphis, Tennessee. Today, I want to talk to you about personal branding. I think that it's a catchphrase that so many people use, but I'm not quite sure everyone really understands what it's for and what it is. So today I want to give you a little background into exactly what personal branding is and a very important example of what it is and how you don't necessarily need social media to get that done. So let's dive into, I knew I'd get that wrong, didn't I? Let's dive into it now. Okay. What is a personal brand? Really, if you want to do the technical term of it, it's widely recognized and largely uniform perception or impression of an individual based on their experience, their expertise, their competencies, and actions or achievements within a community, within an industry, or marketplace at large. I know that's a really technical term, but really what it is, it's your reputation and what you're known for. And what I think that a lot of people misunderstand is that everyone has a personal brand, whether you want one or not, you have one. It's your reputation. And it doesn't necessarily mean you have to be a business owner or somebody creating a side hustle to have a personal brand or to work on your personal brand. If you are known for being late to work, that's part of your personal brand, and you're an employee. If you are known for showing up early and asking really great questions, that's a part of your personal brand. If you are known for being really nice and accommodating and helping people out, that is your personal brand. If you look at Mother Teresa, what do we know her as? Somebody who takes on the world's problems, who is humble, who really dedicated her life to what she did and to helping people, that was her personal brand. Personal branding was, the phrase was coined back in, I believe, the 80s in an Inc. magazine article. You Incorporated is really what it came up with. But really, personal branding has been around for thousands of years. If you look back at the Egyptian pharaohs, they did it with their statues. They did it with their hieroglyphic paintings. They did it with what they wore, everything. But today, I want to take you into something that happened just over 400 years ago. See, personal branding is not a 21st century idea. Even though we think with social media, that's personal branding. It's really not. It goes back to that reputation and what you're known for. So today I want to dive into Queen Elizabeth I. She was excellent at personal branding before there was ever social media. Yes. Now, how did she do it without social media? How did she do it when there was no newspapers, when people oftentimes didn't get news for months later from things that happened? She did it in a series of different things. So she did it with her fashion, with what she wore. She did it with the art that she had commissioned. She did it with the jewelry that she wore. And she did it with daily objects, like putting her face on coins. That was their idea of social media back then. And so today I want to dive into the specifics of those commissioned paintings, because she used that as her social media. She would commission paintings after big events. So if we look at this specific one, you see, Queen Elizabeth, she continues to this day to be recognized as one of the greatest leaders of her time. She ruled as a single woman on the throne of England from 1558 until 1603, in what has been labeled as the Golden Era. While she served as queen, she revolutionized the religious system by establishing the first Protestant, the English Protestant Church. She resisted so many expectations to marry simply based on protocol. She helped the arts blossom, and she expanded the territory and led one of England's largest military victories. And she did this without social media. So while Elizabeth is recognized within her lifetime and soon after her death for her greatness, we still recognize her today for that. If you look at her second in command, so to speak, Elizabeth II, you see many items that she is known for as well. And we're going to dive into some of those elements when we talk about a Queen Elizabeth I. So if we look at this one picture right here, this was commissioned for her coronation. So it's called the coronation portrait. And it was created to memorialize that historic occasion. So if you look at the crown, the scepter, the robe, everything, and the image of her, it showcases leadership. It has details, the crown and the scepter, that symbolize royalty. She's also known for that white face, using that powder on her face all the time. And that also gives a semblance of her being a virgin queen. So now let's look at this portrait. This is called the Darnley portrait, and it was commissioned in 1575. It features Elizabeth in a heavy brocade dress with period's iconic neck and that those wrist ruffles that come up really high, and the neck ruffles that come up really high. The doublet style bodice, it featured details similar to those of a military coat. So she was comparing herself as equal to military leaders. She was the leader of England. She was the leader of its military. And so in her portraits, she wanted everyone to see her like that as well. If you think back thousands of years before that to Ramses the Great, his statues were huge. And all of the details that they put into those statues and into the hieroglyphics, they bespoke certain elements that even though the queen or the pharaoh was not out amongst the people, those portraits, those statues, they were in essence their social media or their Instagram. Now, here is another portrait. This is the Armada portrait. It was commissioned in 1588. So with this, Elizabeth had a success she wanted to celebrate. And she memorialized the event with fashion and with art all of the time. So following the massive defeat of the Spanish Armada in the late 1500s, Elizabeth commissioned this portrait. And as you can see in the portrait itself, it has all of these different details. She still has the coronation crown. She has the elaborate, beautiful dresses on. She has the pearls on. She has other elements in the portrait. A lot of times, if she was given gifts from leaders of other countries that she was partners with, so to speak, she would put those in the paintings as well to show that allegiance to that other person, to make sure they understood, that country understood, that they were important to her and to England. That it's today like we do selfies or we do Instagram lives with people. It's the same concept, just in a different type of framework. Now, let's look at Elizabeth. Here it's 1585. This is the ermine portrait. It was commissioned. So the elaborate details in this portrait, they communicate a message of wealth and power. They communicate purity. The use of the ermine fur to line the dresses or the cloaks instantly gave away to luxury, because only royalty used this special type of fur. And even the ermine was not for the everyday person. It was known to be for the most elite royal figures. So in this, Elizabeth supported her brand and branded herself as a true royal and as the queen that would work for all of the people without compromise. Now in this picture, this is called the, I can't read that small. This is called the, did she portrait, I think. I'm just horribly messing that one up. We'll just forgive me for this one moment. Symbols often seen in her clothing choices, as I've talked about, included that neck ruffle, included the pearls, included the fur. Each fashion detail became part of her brand and her image. This image was commissioned around 1592. Now, what you may be asking is, how can I cultivate my brand image? Very simply, We have it a lot easier these days. We don't have to commission some great portrait or put our face on a coin, because obviously we don't have the ability to do that. But what you can do is your fashion choices, your social media presence, and even your LinkedIn profile. Back in 2010, when I officially started my photography business in Houston, I wanted a very much a magazine style type of photography business. I wanted that style of photography. But what I also realized was, how do I take that from a website? How do I take it from images of how I shoot them when I'm out in front of people and they can't see my work? And what I did was I developed it not only in how I dressed, but also in my business cards. My business cards matched my brand on my website. And all of it together very much gave the illusion of high luxury type photography. The clothing outfits that I wore, they often simulated that same thing, a little bit edgy, but still reserved in some capacity. I loved Coco Chanel, still do. I love the logo of Chanel, the black block letters and the simplicity of that. That is what I always felt my photography style kind of went towards. And that is the branded image that I wanted not only my website and my photography, but also my look to be like. And so even when I couldn't give out my photography work or people couldn't see my website, they could still get that idea of my brand from how I presented myself. And so if you also look at social media, the very first thing I'm going to tell you is that every one of your social media platforms should have this same profile image. You want to be consistent across all platforms. If you're really big into TikTok and to Instagram Reels, even the choice of your music can give some insight into your personal brand. If you think about the city of Memphis, we are known for a specific type of music. Nashville, Tennessee is known for a specific type of music. So if you're going to be a TikTok star, if you're going to use TikTok to help promote your business or your side hustle, even the music that you pick can give away a certain image or reputation or a certain idea of who you are. You see, the idea of a personal brand, it doesn't necessarily mean it's just for social media. It also means when you show up. It goes back to that. Remember when I said if you're known for being late, that's part of your personal brand. And so if you want to take control of that personal brand, you have to start looking at all elements of what you do, all elements of how you show up. Because every single one of those, everything that you're known for is your personal brand. And it doesn't matter if you want one or not. You have one. So why not take control of that and start asking people, when you think of me, what first comes to mind? And see what people say. You know, even if you're looking for a job, what you're known for can help you get that job. I talk a lot about how networking is really important for people, because your next job is going to more than likely come from networking. It's not going to come from a job board. Your next clients are going to come from networking, not from possibly finding you by a Google search. What do they think when they see you? So, over the next few weeks, we're going to be diving into the elements of personal branding to hopefully give you a little bit more insight into what it is and how you can take control of yours. Now, if you want to learn more great tips about what I offer and personal branding in general, you can visit my website, thesocialatelier.com. You can sign up for my newsletter and my profile here. Be sure to follow me so that you're notified of when I go live next. So that is it for today. I hope that you enjoyed this quick, brief history lesson in personal branding and what it is. And I hope that you get a better idea of what it is and how you can take control of yours. So that's it for today, guys. Bye. Have a great rest of the week.